The air we breathe is this extremely precious thing, especially because there is so little of it. The atmosphere is really thin. It's like if you wrapped a single layer of plastic wrap around a basketball. That thin sheet is what makes this tiny little planet in the vast solar system and, as far as we know, universe, able to sustain life. We're going to look at some ways in which human beings have negatively affected the thin layer of Earth's atmosphere by filling it with pollutants. And spoiler alert, some of the main culprits are these guys, vehicles and power plants, particularly those that burn fossil fuels. There's a theme this episode, burning fossil fuels puts a lot of pollutants in the air we breathe. But before we get into that, let's first take a look at what air, or more accurately, the atmosphere, is. This is the atmosphere. It's mostly nitrogen, some oxygen, a dash of argon, and then everything else like neon, helium, and water is a tiny sliver. And notably, carbon dioxide, a molecule we're going to be talking about a lot during the series, because it is so important for understanding climate change, makes up only a very small percentage of the atmosphere. All those gases together, plus any pollutants and dust that end up floating around, make up the atmosphere. We can then divide up the atmosphere by distance from the surface. These layers are the troposphere, stratosphere, mesosphere, thermosphere, and then the exosphere on top. We're only going to focus on two layers of the atmosphere, the troposphere and the stratosphere. The troposphere is where most of environmental science happens. All life forms, all biogeochemical cycles, weather patterns, big and small, everything. The stratosphere is important though, because that's where the ozone layer is. Now, a small point of clarification, ozone is three oxygen molecules bonded together. Down here in the troposphere, you don't want it. It's real bad. It's a pollutant that people make, a component of photochemical smog, which is just as bad as it sounds, and is related to a whole host of respiratory issues. However, in the stratosphere, stratospheric ozone is amazing. It's our planet's sunscreen. The ozone layer blocks out the vast majority of the sun's harmful ultraviolet radiation, and without it, life would not exist as we know it. All organisms on this planet have evolved with this small amount of UV radiation that makes it onto the surface of our planet. And that includes us. And that's why when people go into space, radiation is a huge worry, because we aren't built to experience the full power of the sun. Fortunately for our soft, UV-sensitive bodies, most of the ozone in the atmosphere is up in the stratosphere, in the ozone layer. Up there, the physical properties of the ozone molecule allow it to absorb all the UVC and most of the UVB radiation. UVA and some UVB still makes its way to the Earth's surface. The difference between UVC, UVB, UVA is the energy levels. UVC has a longer wavelength, but they're all still within the ultraviolet section of the light spectrum. This is getting dangerously close to physics, so let's get back to the ozone layer. Most ultraviolet radiation gets stopped at the door, but some of it gets through, and it has some benefits. It helps people create vitamin D, but also has risks. Exposure can cause cataracts in your eyes or skin cancer. Wear sunscreen and sunglasses, people. However, if we didn't have the ozone layer, there is no amount of sunscreen that could protect us. And that almost happened. People started using these miracle chemicals called chlorofluorocarbons, or CFCs. Long story short, that chloro, which stands for chlorine, pops off the carbon chain when exposed to UV radiation. Then that rogue chlorine tears an oxygen out of an ozone molecule. The fancy name for this is ozone depletion, and that led to what you might have heard referred to as the ozone hole. Fortunately, humans collectively got their act together and banned CFCs under the Montreal Protocol in 1987. You can learn all about that in this video. Here's the important takeaway. The story of stratospheric ozone depletion is a great example of science understanding a problem, identifying the culprit, and legislative and international bodies coming together to ban that very substance, and eventually seeing a recovery in our Earth system. Now, let's bring it down a layer, back home into the troposphere, to talk about air pollution. Air pollution is a pretty broad category that encompasses anything in the air that harms us or any other organism. And it's a pretty big deal. An estimated 5 to 6 million people die every year due to air pollution, primarily from related respiratory problems. Breathing in foreign particles and chemicals is not good for the precious system in here. In the United States, the body that is tasked with monitoring and protecting us from air pollutants is the Environmental Protection Agency, or EPA. The EPA has 6 air pollutants that they continuously monitor all over the country, and they're called criteria pollutants. NOx, SOx, particulate matter, lead, carbon monoxide, and ozone. There's dozens and dozens, if not hundreds, of different types of air pollutants out there, but these 6 are consistently tested and measured all over the country because we can tie each one of them to specific human activities, which makes monitoring and enforcing air quality standards easier. You might have noticed a pattern in these names. A lot have ox or oxide, nitrogen dioxide, sulfur dioxide, carbon monoxide. That oxide is a result of combustion. When things are burned that have sulfur in it, that makes SOx, sulfur oxides. When things are burned that have nitrogen in them, that makes NOx, nitrogen oxides. If they have carbon, carbon monoxide. So if you hear oxide or ox, that means something has probably been burned. For reasons that will become painfully obvious, we're going to talk a lot about power plant emissions this episode, so I think it's worth taking a second to know what we're looking at. This is a power plant, and you can see two types of smokestacks, or flues. The large one with curved sides, that's a cooling tower. All that's coming out of there is water vapor. The smaller, thinner smokestacks, that's where you'll find SOx, NOx, LEADs, and other dangerous pollutants. Okay, let's start with NOx and SOx. Why should we be worried about these oxides? Both are highly reactive and are emitted when fuels are burned at high temperature. For NOx, the big emitters are cars, construction equipment, boats, and power plants. SOx comes almost entirely from coal-fired power plants and some other industrial processes. And lucky for us, nitrogen oxide and sulfur oxides are poisonous. They're bad for our respiratory system, can impact plant growth, and react with the air to make acid rain. The formal term for this is acid deposition. In the air, NOx reacts to create nitric acid, and SOx creates sulfuric acid, which then fall to the ground. It's an acid, so it can burn through structures we built, damaging buildings, statues, you name it. And of course, it's dangerous to humans and other organisms. Here's a chart showing the critical pH levels that organisms cannot survive in. Take this cute crayfish. Below 5.5, it dies. Acid deposition lowers the pH of water and soil, making them more acidic, and that can have serious ramifications throughout an ecosystem. The US has actually done a pretty okay job of reducing SOx emissions from power plants, partly through regulation, improvements in smokestack scrubbers, and other cleaning technology. But also, the economic viability of coal isn't so hot these days. So while acid deposition still has serious consequences, it isn't as prevalent as it once was. There's another serious consideration when it comes to oxides, especially NOx, and that's photochemical smog, which we'll come back to later. So next on the list, this is particulate matter, the solid stuff in the air. So not a gas like NOx and SOx, but solid particles that are small enough to be airborne. This could be smoke, dust, or soot particles like ash and lead, or pollen. Near coal power plants, having tiny pieces of mercury in the air is not uncommon. And most of these, whether from natural or anthropogenic, the fancy word for human, sources can be dangerous to our health. The US EPA categorizes particulate matter into two sizes, PM10, anything smaller than 10 micrometers across, and PM2.5, anything smaller than 2.5 micrometers across. In general, the smaller the particulate matter, the more dangerous it is to us. Particulate matter comes in many shapes, sizes, and origins, some of which are even beneficial, important elements of the Earth's system. Dust from windstorms in the Saharan Desert in Africa adds phosphorus to the soils in the Amazon, an ocean away, to make up for nutrient loss from flooding and surface runoff. Although dust particles are small, no larger than around a tenth of the width of a human hair, they form massive plumes that can be seen from space. This footage is from NASA's Calypso satellite. This data shows that on average, 182 million tons of dust leaves Africa each year, 27 million tons of which ends up in the Amazon basin. However, anthropogenic sources of particle pollution are often not so beneficial. Power plants, especially coal-fired power plants, are responsible for large concentrations of particulate matter. This map of the United States shows the concentrations and sources for particulate matter. Notice it is especially dense in the eastern US, which is also where the majority of the US population lives. So those pollution-generating plants are providing electricity, but they are also poisoning the air we breathe, where we breathe it. Relevant to right now, the spring of 2020, the novel coronavirus has had a dramatic impact on the amount of particulate matter in the air. This example happens to come from India. You can see in 2016, 17, 18, 19, there are heavy layers of particulate matter in the atmosphere. But now, in March of 2020, we see a big drop. With much of the world sheltering in place and less vehicle traffic and different demands on power grids as a result, here India, but also the rest of the world, is producing far fewer air pollutants. Next up on the list of nasty things in the air, lead. The main sources of lead in the United States are smelting ore or metal processing, as well as aircraft fuel. Lead actually used to be a much bigger air pollution problem in the US, but because of the EPA regulations, we no longer use leaded gasoline in our cars. Lead still makes the list though because it is a scary neurotoxin that affects cognition and brain development. And if that wasn't bad enough, it persists for a long time, especially if it's been deposited into the soil. It's worth mentioning that lead is also a serious water pollutant. The NRDC has a tracker that shows you all the places in the US that exceed the EPA's lead action level. So some of these pollutants that are dangerous in the air because we can breathe them in can also have serious impacts if we consume them through our drinking water or they get into the food system. Okay, next up on our list of doom, carbon monoxide. Carbon monoxide is extra devious because it is a serious outdoor and indoor air pollutant. And like other oxides, carbon monoxide is produced when something is burned, like fossil fuels or biomass or a gas stove or even a forest. Here you can see there's a high concentration of carbon monoxide in the troposphere over Africa and Southeast Asia. These levels are from massive forest fires. Carbon monoxide is colorless and odorless, so you can't see it when it's in the air, but it is really, really toxic to us humans. It blocks the activity of hemoglobin so our blood can't carry oxygen around and we suffocate. And now let's bring it full circle and talk about ozone again. But remember, good up high, bad nearby. Tropospheric or ground level ozone is a human-made secondary air pollutant. That's a mouthful, so let's unpack what that means. Ground level ozone wouldn't exist without people, but we call it secondary because we don't directly produce it. Rather, it's the end result of a series of chemical reactions. Basically, NOx from vehicle emissions plus volatile organic compounds, or VOCs, plus sunlight makes tropospheric ozone. And when that ozone is all mixed together with a slurry of pollutants like particulate matter already in the atmosphere, you end up with photochemical smog, a dangerous thick haze that can form over large cities. That isn't smoke. It's like the criteria pollutants combined into one evil super Voltron of pollution. And if you're too young to know what Voltron is, well, this is YouTube. You can go watch a few things after we're done. So the criteria pollutants are super serious, and the best ways to reduce the impact and spread of these pollutants? Reduced fossil fuel burning. So that means fewer coal plants and fewer internal combustion engines. But as I've mentioned a couple times, the US has in general improved its air quality over the last several decades. And a lot of these regulations and ingenious pollution reducing devices, like catalytic converters reducing NOx pollution from cars, or scrubbers and coal smokestacks trapping sulfur dioxide, are a result of the Clean Air Act. The Clean Air Act is up there as one of the most fundamental and life-changing pieces of legislation ever enacted in the United States. Effectively, it gives the Environmental Protection Agency the authority to set limits on air pollutants, and importantly, enforce those limits. Carbon monoxide, sulfur dioxide, VOCs, NOx, particulate matter, they've all seen a dramatic decrease since the Clean Air Act. Even since 1990, we can see huge decreases in some of these air pollutants. Compared to where the US was, there have been dramatic improvements. Though we still have a long way to go in securing clean, healthy air for everyone. We've been focusing on outdoor air pollutants, but there is a whole class of indoor air pollutants that affect human health and performance. But because they happen inside people's homes, these are much harder to test for and regulate. Now, obviously, we've only talked about a handful of air pollutants, and there are many, many more. But there is one tricky substance in the air that we're gonna talk about a lot in this series that we haven't discussed in the context of air pollution. Carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide plays a huge role in our planet's climate and climate change, but it isn't really an air pollutant, at least not in the sense that carbon dioxide itself harms human health. I mean, I'm talking right now, and as I'm releasing CO2 as I breathe, but that's not the same as criteria pollutants that we've talked about earlier. When we talk about carbon dioxide, we want to implicate it as one of the main greenhouse gases, along with methane and nitrous oxide, that are both essential to life on this planet, but also in current concentrations are making it increasingly hot in here. So to wrap up, air pollution affects human health, animal health, and plant health. While there are natural sources of air pollution, the most serious emitters are us, and in particular when people burn fossil fuels or organic material. Tropospheric air pollution has seen serious improvements in the United States thanks to the Clean Air Act, and globally because of other environmental legislation and technological advances. And way up high, the stratospheric ozone layer is recovering thanks to the Montreal Protocol. These issues haven't been completely solved, but with continued strengthening of regulations and reductions in fossil fuel use, we hopefully won't be dealing with air pollution forever.